So hello everyone. We are here. First of all, a very happy festival to all of you. We have today a session which is an interactive session about visual pathway and its lesions. Okay. So basically, it's not going to be like your theory class. And most of all the slides today are only pictures, and it's you who is going to talk more. So it's only to make us realize why we are learning, what we are learning, okay? So I don't want it to be like a by heart, okay, I learn these things. It is to make us realize how it is important in clinical scenario, all right? So I'll be sharing my screen now. Just let me know if it's visible to all of you. So is it?
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
Yeah, thank you. Mm-hmm. All right. So we'll be begin. So all of you, I assume, would have read and come for this class because that's what was told to you, to read the visual pathway and its lesions. So we'll begin with a slide which you all must have seen, must have drawn, must have voluntarily, like, you know, this is so very common. So either Pallavi, you can just start with the left hand side of the screen, that is this picture. You can start explaining this picture however you want it.
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah,
here we are seeing the visual pathway,
right?
And we can see the optic nerve, which starts from the retina, where the ganglionic axons of the ganglionic cell layer all meet together and form the optic nerve. And both the left and right optic nerves meet up at the chiasma, where there will be crossover of the few fibers. Here we can see that the temporal fibers go to the same side, and the small part of the nasal fibers, they move on to the opposite side in the chiasma. And later it becomes the optic tract. And from the optic tract, it goes to the lateral geniculate nucleus of the thalamus. And from here, we get the optic radiations, which will finally go to the optic cortex, a visual cortex, which is present in the occipital lobe, area 17, 18, and 19.
Excellent. Okay. So what you've told, what Pallavi has told, a round of applause for her. The thing is, you are very right in saying that it starts from the optic nerve, where you have the retinal ganglion nerve fiber layer. The thing that you all have to know today is that the temporal retina has the nasal field. Okay. And the nasal retina has the temporal field. So this one concept is going to help us throughout our session today. So the temporal retina gets the nasal field of vision, whereas the nasal retina gets the temporal field of vision. Any doubts here, please ask in the chat section, or you can unmute yourself and talk. After that, we have the optic nerve per se, then the optic chiasma, where she told that the nasal fibers cross over. And then you have the optic tract, lateral geniculate body, optic radiations, and then the visual cortex. This is how a normal visual pathway is. Today, we are going to discuss only up till the chiasma, and the thing we'll probably do in the next session, okay? So, Kunj, now I want you to tell me what is there on the right-hand side of this picture.
So, on the right-hand side, that depending upon the location of the lesion, depending on the location, what will the corresponding visual defect is described?
Yeah, very good.
So, for example, if we begin from the marking.
Yeah, A point. Yeah.
A point means the lesion is within the orbit before the beginning of the optic nerve.
Okay.
So, depending upon the nerve fibers which are affected in the,
excellent,
that particular corresponding visual field, there will be a scotoma. So for example,
I am truly very, very happy with this answer. What do you think is affected in this first picture? Which fiber do you think is affected in this picture?
In this picture, the central, the papillomacular fibers can be affected.
Excellent.
So the center scotoma can be seen here.
Yeah, so it's the macula that is affected. So you have the papillomacular bundle, which is affected in this, which is giving rise to the central scotoma. This is very good. You earn brownie points from me for this answer. Next.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
And then in the B lesion, the entire optic nerve on the right side is affected. So
okay.
So the entire right vision will be affected. So there's a complete anopia on the right side. The left side is normal, so there is no.
Just a minute. Kunj, can you tell our viewers what is anopia?
Anopia is complete loss of vision. Entire.
Very good. Vision. Yeah. So what is hemianopia?
Hemianopia is a partial loss of vision, semicircular loss of vision on one side.
Semi is half. So yeah, half of the visual field is gone. Partial can be your pie in the sky and things like that also. All right. So you can tell half of the visual field is affected in hemianopia. Good. Continue.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. And quadranopia is one quadrant of the visual field is affected.
Excellent. You can continue from this B part.
So in the B part, the entire optic nerve on the right side is affected. It is a lesion on the entire right side. So both the nasal and the temporal fibers are affected. So on the visual field, we get a complete anopia on the right side, while the left side is normal.
Correct. And next.
Then the lesion C is a lesion of the optic chiasma, where there is a crossing over of the nasal fibers on the both the sides.
Very good.
So in the optic chiasma lesion, only the nasal fibers will be affected, because the temporal fibers are nowhere in the crossing area, in the junction of the optic chiasma. So since the nasal fibers correspond to the temporal visual field of the same side, so because of the lesion of the right nasal field, there would be a defect on the right temporal field. And because of the lesion of the left nasal side, there's a defect, heavy anopia on the left temporal side. So it is an heteronymous bitemporal hemianopia would be seen.
Very good. I really appreciate the word heteronymous. Can you tell me what is homonymous?
Homonymous means when we see on the visual, the perimetry, the defect would be seen on the same side. So if it is on the left side, then on the left of the left vision and left of the right vision, means the nasal of the right vision and temporal of the left vision. That is homonymous.
It's on the same side, either the right sides of both the eye or the left sides of both the eyes. Okay. So that constitutes the word homonymous. So up till the chiasma, whenever you see a lesion, it's going to be heteronymous. That means either it's going to be on one. See, if this we consider, it's going to be the right side of the right eye and the left side of the left eye. Okay. So the sides are different in both the eyes. Correct. Next.
Then in the D lesion, there's a lesion of the optic tract. So in this, there's a right optic tract affected. So the fibers affected are right temporal fibers and left nasal fibers, which have crossed at the optic chiasma.
Correct.
So
in
the corresponding visual field defect, there will be defect of the left nasal field and the right temporal field.
If the right tract is affected, you have the opposite side, homonymous hemianopia. So if you have the right tract, this thing, you have to tell it is left side of both the eyes. So it has to be left temporal. And right nasal, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I hope it's clear to all the viewers there. Any doubts, you can put it in the chat section, all right? Continue.
In E and F lesions, they are in the optic radiations, which are originating from the left geniculate body. So there are two types of optic radiations. One which originates from the LGB. It goes superiorly via the parietal lobe, and then ends in the visual cortex. That is, it carries the superior fibers, also called as Baum's loop.
Excellent. Yeah.
While second set of optic radiations originate from LGB and they traverse via the temporal lobe and to end into the optic cortex, occipital cortex. So they carry the inferior fibers that are called as Mayer's loop.
Very good. Yeah.
So in E, it is the superior fibers which will be affected. So as the superior, so on the right side, superior fibers will be affected of the right temporal and the left nasal. So
see, these are the inferior fibers. Okay, these are the superior fibers because E is giving you. Yeah.
Okay. Huh, fine.
Just look at it again. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. So E is.
That's right. What you're telling is correct, but just you interchanged a little. But yeah, correct.
Yes, ma'am. So E will be the inferior fibers affected of the right optic radiations, which include the right temporal fibers and the left basal. So right superior. So right inferior temporal and right left. Inferonasal. So the visual field defect would be the corresponding to that. That is right superonasal and left superotemporal. So it is like a pie in the sky appearance.
Okay, correct. Yeah. So basically, you have the inferior fibers, which is going to the temporal lobe. How you can remember is this IT. Okay, IT. So if you just remember, inferior is for temporal, superior is for parietal lobes. Okay, so for this is for everyone. So inferior fibers always go to the temporal lobe. So here the inferior fibers are affected. So you have the superior visual field defect. Okay, so when you have the superior visual field defect, you're going to see pi in the sky. Okay.
Yes.
And if you have the inferior visual field defect, that is when the superior fibers are involved, that is going to the parietal lobe. Then you will have pi on the floor.
Pi on the floor, yes.
Correct. Okay. So anybody, any doubts? Nothing, right? Pallavi, can you join in? Can you tell the last one?
In the last one here, we can see that there will be lesion in the visual cortex. That is in the occipital lobe. And here there will be... because of the involvement of in the right visual cortex, there will be the left-sided field involvement. On the left side, it will be left temporal and the right nasal field will be involved, and there will be macular sparing. Macular sparing will be present in this, and If there is any, the tip of the occipital cortex is involved, then there will be macular defects also, because that area
is supplied by the
PCA artery, the posterior cerebral artery. If PCA and MCA is affected, then the macula will be affected on that side also.
Very good. Both of you, I really thank you for making this an easy affair to me. So I hope you both can continue. Is that okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Is that okay with both of you to continue? Anybody else who wants to join, please write in the chat section. We'll unmute you. Okay. So I hope. So what we till now, whatever we have discussed, is basically what we already know. All right. So it's just the visual pathway and the defects, the theory part of it, which we have been learning in our clinics. So let us start with this first case, just to make you realize how this is important in our daily routine. Okay. So we have a 11-year-old female girl presenting to our OPD with painful movements in the right eye. And sorry, any problem? I heard somebody, anything?
No, ma'am.
Is that clear? What am I audible to everyone?
Yes, ma'am, you're audible, ma'am.
Okay, cool. So we have an 11-year-old female here who has painful movements in the right eye. Okay, she's noticed it, and her parents have got her to our OPD. And on seeing, you see something called as an RAPD. So would you like to say what an RAPD is?
Relative afferent pupillary defect.
Correct.
Or Marcus gun pupil.
Excellent. Yeah.
When we do the swinging flashlight reflex, in case the consensual light reflex is not seen and the other pupil is not constricting, then that is known in relation to the direct reflex. If that is known as RAPD.
Kunz, would you like to add something?
Yes. So in RAPD, like for example, if you take an it's a basically a lesion of an optic nerve in which the...
No, you describe only RAPD to me. Don't go to causes.
Okay, so in the swinging light test, like for example, if the right optic nerve is affected, if we swing direct the streak of light on the right from right temporal side, there won't be any pupillary constriction on the right side as well as on the left side. So there's an absence of direct light reflex as well as consensual light reflex. However, if we then project the streak of light over the left side, which is normal, so there would be a direct light reflex on the left side, means the ipsilateral side, which will show pupillary constriction. As well as on the consensual light reflex, means on the right side also the pupil will show constriction. So now, so, if we again swing it back towards the right side, so in that case, like because there is no light reflex happening on the right side, we will see a dilatory effect seen on the pupil. That is because the pupil, which was constricted because of the consensual light reflex from the left side, it is now coming back to its normal size. So that is a relative apparent pupillary defect. So it is a relative phenomenon, which is actually not dilating, but it's a contrary, because we feel that normally by projecting light, it should constrict, but it is dilating. So that
very good. What Pallavi said is also correct. Okay, what Pallavi said is also correct, but that is termed as something called as reverse RAPD, where you only check for the consensual light reflex. So that's a homework for you guys. Okay, so where do you see when will you not be able to appreciate the direct light reflex? See, you said that we'll see the consensual light reflex and we'll come to know which eye is involved. This is PG level question, okay? Just because you people answered, I'm asking you. What is reverse? This term is called as reverse RAPD, where you check for the consensual light reflex. This is in case where you can't elicit the direct reflex. When do you think you can't elicit the direct reflex? It's okay even if you can't answer. I told you, it's a PG level question. But if you answer, if you just go in that direction, I'll be very happy.
If any pathway of the reflex tract is affected.
Exactly, correct. If the third, see, the light reflex is carried by second and third nerve, right? Yes, so if your pupil, the third nerve palsy is there, or you can have any lesions like, you know, traumatic atrophy or any atrophy of the iris, which is not letting it constrict properly, then you will not be able to elicit the direct reflex. That time, you'll have to see for a consensual light reflex to elicit the RAPD. This is not for everyone. Even if you didn't understand or don't break your head on this, nobody is going to ask this question to you. But just because the discussion went in that way, I'm just asking you this. Okay, so for you to have elicit an RAPD, you have to have a proper efferent and an efferent in the other eye. Okay, only then you can make out that there is RAPD in one eye. If both eyes efferents are gone, you won't be able to elicit an RAPD. All right. So coming back to our case, which is an 11-year-old female with this RAPD she's having in the right eye. And obviously, I would like to see a fundus picture, which is shown here. I'll read out the fundus for you. I don't expect you to tell anything, but see, the disc margins are slightly blurred and the disc is slightly hyperemic. Okay. So the disc margins are slightly blurred and the disc is hyperemic. Apart from that, the whole fundus looks normal to me. I also tell her to, okay, just get a visual field done. And this is her visual field. Okay. This is of the right eye and this is of the left eye. Any comments you want to give at this point? What would you want to do next? Or what do you think is happening in her? Both of you, any of you can, either an investigation that you want to order or probably in what direction you want to go. So we've memorized the whole visual pathway. Now I am asking you some case related to this, which might help us.
On the right side, central paracentral scotoma is present.
Okay, very good, very good. Yeah, you see some depressed points in the central area. Correct? No.
Okay.
Area is affected, we can do a visual acuity for seeing if the macula is affected or not.
Okay, I did a visual function
test can be done.
Very good. Okay, I did a visual acuity and I'm telling you that the visual acuity in the right eye is 6/18.
Okay.
So what next do you want to do? Anything? Where is your direction going towards?
Macular pathology. Okay.
See, we are discussing visual pathway and I'm telling you central scotoma. Mm. So initially when you started only you told no.
So optic nerve can be affected.
Optic nerve can be affected. So what do you think can be anything? When do you think neuritis. This kind of? Yes, correct.
Optic neuritis, it affects the central area first. So.
Yeah, correct. So optic neuritis, which investigation would you want? First to do, it's there, all you've read in Kurana. This is a case of optic neuritis, CT. I'm telling you. Yeah, CT. Do you think CT will give us an optic nerve pathology properly? Which other investigations? CTs are more for bone pathology, right?
Yes.
Nerve and muscles and all, where do you see properly?
ORG.
No. Yeah, what you are saying is correct, Pallavi.
MRI.
Correct, MRI. So we did an MRI for this child and this is what comes out to be. There is some amount of inflammatory enhancement of the right optic nerve. Okay, you're seeing that. Can you see?
Yes.
Yeah, so we are confirming this case to be a optic neuritis. And probably what is the treatment for optic neuritis?
Steroids.
Steroids. Correct. B+11. Yeah, great. It is ONTT trial where you have optic neuritis treatment trial where you give IVMP, that is IV
methylphenidazole
1 gram.
For 3 days.
Correct.
1 gram per day and then for 11 days, 1 milligram per kg per body and then you taper down the steroids.
Exactly, correct. Okay, so that is your treatment for optic neuritis. So this is a brownie point again. Supposedly that was not her MRI, okay? And you had an MRI with this kind of a picture and you also know that there were prior bouts of optic neuritis in the left eye in this patient. What would you think? There's a clue there. This is the clue. This is the MRI. And this is normally asked in what you call NEET exams. They'll give you a picture or probably something like that. Anything, any abnormality, do you see any abnormality in this MRI?
Raised intracranial tension?
No, you can't see that on an MRI. See, I mean, I don't know, I'm not a radiologist, but what is striking to you in this MRI as a layman?
The ventricles are not clearly visible.
Yeah, ventricles are not visible. And what next to the ventricles can you see? Some white things, yeah. You can tell like that.
Area.
Yeah, very good. Yeah, you are seeing some hyperintense lesions, okay? So you are seeing something like an hyperintense or a white matter periventricular lesion, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
This is ventricle, so this is periventricular. Periventricular white matter lesions you are seeing, correct? No?
Yes.
Correct. So this looks like fingers, okay? That is called as Dawson's fingers. D-A-W-S-O-N. Dawson's fingers, and it is characteristic of which demyelinating disorder?
Multiple sclerosis.
Very good, excellent. Multiple sclerosis is the most common demyelinating disorder which presents as optic neuritis, okay? And on an MRI, you would see Dawson's fingers, which is again characteristic. So these are some of the, catch points that they normally ask in your NEET exams or, other entrance exams. So you can remember it this way. So now you know that a case of optic neuritis, which probably presents to you with pain in the eye, with RAPD, with some centrosecal scotomas, with the MRI showing some periventricular white matter lesions, So you can about relate that this is also somewhere in the visual pathway, correct? The first part of the visual pathway where the macular fibers are affected. Why is the macular fibers affected first in any compressive or inflammatory lesion?
Because any they are the innermost fibers in the optic nerve. So correct. Any compression would affect the innermost fibers first.
Correct. They are more sensitive. They are more sensitive than any other fiber. Not that the other part of the nasal temporal would not get affected. It will slowly, but the starting would be the most sensitive, which is the macular fibers. Okay. Excellent. I'm very happy with this. So next we have another case, which is a 68-year-old lady. Again, she had acute myeloid leukemia in her past. Okay. This is how your questions will be. It's the very easy, same topic, but they'll give you like as though it's something really big, okay? So I'm also giving it to you that way. A 68-year-old lady with acute myeloid leukemia with a painless loss of vision in her right eye again. And she also has RAPD. And this is her fundus photo, which I'll tell you what it is. We are not able to see the disc margins again. There are peripapillary hemorrhages and no disc margins. Disc edema is there. And this is the visual field. So don't be scared when you get such a visual field, okay? You might get only the grayscale like the previous one, like this, or you might get the entire Humphrey field. This is called the Humphrey field analysis, where the entire visual field is there, okay? The grayscale, the total pattern deviation, and other things which you need not bother about. You can just see the grayscale and tell me what is happening. And this is her MRI picture, okay? So what do you think is happening in her? You don't have to break your head onto too many things. Just see the picture and try to get. This is the most easy way to go about in this picture.
There is complete anopia of
field. Complete anopia in the right eye. This is the right visual field, no?
Yes.
So there is complete anopia.
So the nerve can be involved. The
correct.
Nerve might, there is some mass over there.
Yeah, very good. Yeah. So you're not able to see the optic nerve also, see properly. There is disc edema. Okay, there are hemorrhages. So there is optic disc edema. And in the MRI, you're seeing some infiltration that is happening. So it's probably leptomeningeal mets that has happened. Okay. So really the AML doesn't play a great role here. The only thing as an ophthalmologist or probably in this, you are worried about is that there is some infiltration happening because of the cancer or whatever. In the optic nerve sheath, which is compressing it and then which is giving you complete anopia in the right eye, correct?
Okay. Yes. Yes.
And that is also causing the RAPD.
Okay.
Okay. Now, if I tell you that this was a case, forget about this part of the picture, okay? This part, just get this kind of a picture and there is a history of trauma. Okay. What would you think? You have no fundus photo and no MRI. I will just give you this picture and say it's the right visual field. Patient comes with a history of trauma. What is the cause? Most probable cause.
Traumatic optic nerve damage.
Yeah, optic nerve avulsion. Okay. That's the first thing that you would have read in your standard UG books as the cause of optic nerve lesion. Optic nerve lesion because optic nerve avulsion. Optic neuritis, all these are the causes of the complete anopia in that same eye, okay? And in yes. that situation, what do you think would be the pupil? Complete optic nerve avulsion. Do you think you will see a direct reflex?
No.
Oh, no.
No. So there will be no direct reflex in that eye. So no consensual reflex in the other eye also. What about near reflex?
Even that would be absent.
Absent? Present? That's homework, okay? So what will be the near reflex in a case of optic nerve damage, like optic nerve avulsion? Whether it will be intact or whether it will be going. That's the homework for the next session. So we have two sessions. So believe me, I'll keep asking you this, whatever homework I've given you. So we'll go ahead with the next. In this case, see, what would be the treatment? We'll give a chemo radiation, intrathecal chemo radiation or anything which would probably decrease the infiltration to the optic nerve and she might regain the vision. But in optic nerve emulsion, you can't do anything. Okay?
Under speech, what is the greenish discoloration?
I'll tell you. It's not the greenish. The way when you take the photo, no. Sometimes there will be a glare that way. So it's just that. The greenish is not anything to do with the fundus in this picture.
Okay ma'am. Yes,
when you take a real-time photo of a fundus, it just sometimes it just happens. Sometimes there are lesions, okay? There are acute retinal necrosis and all that is not required for you. CMV retinitis also can produce some greenish discoloration, but not needed, okay? In this case, it's probably just an artifact, okay?
Okay.
All these pictures, by the way, are taken from standard PG books. So mostly they'll be the same books from which they will take for your exams as well. So Hiranmayi, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, you can volunteer for this case. Yeah. See, it's a female patient who comes with amenorrhea, galactorrhea, and infertility. To you, okay? She comes to you and you are my friend and you will be very busy first year PG in your OPD. And you will say, ma'am, she gives me vague oftal complaints and I have no time to elicit what is wrong with her. Please see her fundus.
Okay, ma'am.
Oh my God, somebody's already into diagnosis. Yes.
Prolactinoma.
Okay, why do you think it's prolactinoma?
Because of galactorrhea and... It can compress the pituitary stalk and so that will cause decreased release of gonadotrophins and all those things. So there will be amenorrhea and infertility.
Okay.
So
why am I bothered now? Hiranmayi's case. Why should I be bothered?
It can compress the optic nerve.
Optic nerve?
Chiasma, sorry.
Okay, chiasma. Okay. Then what? Now, why is this picture there? What do you see? Anything you can see in this picture? So, I look at the picture, okay? First thing I would do is I'll just get a fundus photo and I see this picture. Do you see any abnormality here? Yes, no. Answer is very simple. You might not understand this picture. You can just tell whatever you feel like.
There are abnormalities.
What abnormality?
CDR is changed slightly.
Sorry?
Cup disc ratio is increased.
Okay.
Increased.
Oh my God. Okay. Now you think it's a glaucomatous disc? Oh. Okay. I'll let you know. Fine. The disc is normal. Okay. The disc is normal and you see some amount of pallor here. Can you make out? Can you see where I'm pointing the arrow? This color and this color is slightly different. This is a lighter version. Correct?
Yes, ma'am.
So we call it as disc pallor, a small amount of pale disc on the temporal half of the disc. Otherwise, you have some tessellated background, which might be there in many myopic patients. So rest of the retina looks normal apart from this being slightly paler than the nasal half of the disc, okay? The temporal half of the disc is slightly paler than the nasal half of the disc. So next, I would like to get a visual field done, which is like this. Comment on this visual field.
Bitemporal hemianopia.
Very good, because you are seeing this is of the right eye and this is of the left eye. So you are seeing a complete depressed area here and here, correct? So you are having a bitemporal hemianopia. So you come and this is your MRI picture, which is giving you some pituitary macroadenoma kind of a picture, correct?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, this is the optic, this is where your optic chiasma will also come, correct?
Yes. Yes.
This is how your visual pathway is. So there is a macroadenoma which is pressing over the chiasma and then you are getting this kind of a visual field, this kind of an fundus photo and she's presenting to you like this. What will you do? What will you do is the Hiranmayi should answer. I'll just say that it's in some pituitary thing. You please manage. Okay. So let me come back. What nystagmus do you see in this patient? If at all you want to see. Kunj, you're there?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. It's not very common. It's very rarely seen, this kind of nystagmus, but it's a classic MCQ question. What is the nystagmus that is seen in bitemporal hemianopia or pituitary lesions? You have a picture which is a clue for you.
Seesaw.
Very good. It's seesaw nystagmus, okay? Okay. Do you know that what is seesaw nystagmus?
No, ma'am.
No. So, okay, you can, I tried very much, okay, but yeah, sorry. I really tried a lot to download that video, but due to security reasons, it didn't allow me to. So I request you all to just type seesaw nystagmus on YouTube and you can see two or three videos. What is a seesaw nystagmus is that one eye will elevate and intort, whereas the other eye will depress and extort. Okay. So you not have a common normal nystagmus that you see in the horizontal way like this. No. You will have one eye which is elevating and intorting and the other eye which is depressing and extorting. This intortion, extortion, you might not notice on torchlight, but the elevation and depression you can. Okay. So one eye will be elevating, the other eye will be same time going down. Okay. This is the classical feature of, you know, bitemporal hemianopia, but it's not very commonly seen. It's a very rare thing. Now, what kind of an optic atrophy would you see in such patients? Again, there's a clue for you. What is this?
Bowtie.
Correct. Bowtie atrophy. Okay. So why does the bowtie atrophy occur? See, I told you here, this is the macula. Okay. This part will be the macula. If you have any doubts, please stop me there and then, okay? So if this is the macula, so we consider the macula to be the center when we are taking the visual fields, okay? So yes. This entire part is the nasal half, okay? So yes, from here till here is the nasal half. So the nasal fibers are getting crossed over, correct? Yes. When they're getting crossed over or they are getting compressed because of this pituitary lesion, you will have the fibers that are coming this part of the disc and at this part of the disc, both. I told you in this picture, there is only pallor here. But if there is pallor here and here, it look like a bow tie.
Okay.
I'm moving my arrow in that same direction, okay? So if both the fibers, both sides fibers are affected, this papillomacular bundle and these nasal fibers, both are getting compressed in the optic chiasma because they both constitute the nasal part of your retinal fibers, which are getting compressed. So the atrophy, the optic atrophy would be classically a bow tie kind of an optic atrophy. Okay. So this is also a neat question, which is commonly asked. So I'm just trying to make it very clear and conceptual so that you don't have to by heart it. Okay. So very well, then we'll go to this. These pictures are again taken from a textbook called Iskansky, which is again a standard textbook. So this is the pituitary gland. If it has to enlarge, if there has to be a suprasellar extension, then it would come to this part of the chiasma. Okay. In the chiasma, you have the nasal fibers only, but the lower nasal fibers are more anterior. Then you have the macular fibers. Then you have the upper nasal fibers. So when you have a pituitary lesion, it is going to first compress the lower nasal fibers. So what do you think will be the visual field like?
The superotemporal side of both the sides will be affected.
Ah, very good. Superotemporal of both the sides. Don't answer it as pie in the sky. Okay. It is going to be somewhat like this. Okay, just because it is in the starting phase, okay? The starting phase would be the lower nasal fibers, so the upper temporal fibers would be gone, but slowly it will come up to the whole thing and it will be bitemporal. So even if you get a visual field like this, okay, in your exam, don't transfer it as pie in the sky. Instead, go for an option which gives you a chiasma lesion or anything which is suggestive of that. Okay? I hope that is clear. And this is one of the things which you need to remember. These are the common things that you have to remember for chiasma lesions. I think there is a mnemonic also. PC, AC, something. Okay, so it can be pituitary adenomas, craniopharyngioma, glioma, and then aneurysms. If you know these many, I think that would be sufficient enough for your exams. So let us go ahead with this thing now. So this is a craniopharyngioma. What do you think it is compressing?
Compressed from the superior surface, the superior.
Yeah, it is coming from the upper side, correct.
So the nasal fibers will be affected.
Correct. So it is the craniopharyngeal is coming like this. So the upper nasal fibers are first affected. So you will have the inferior fields that are affected first. Okay?
Temporal.
Yeah, inferior temporal, and then it will go up to, as the lesion increases, it can go up to the whole bitemporal fields. Fine.
Yes.
Then this is another picture, which is a sphenoidal ridge meningioma. This is a sphenoid bone, okay? So, yeah, sphenoidal ridge meningioma, and on appearance, the patient might look like this. Some reactive hyperostosis is also present. So, what do you think? So, I've explained you two pictures. Now, I want someone to explain this. If you want a clue, I'll tell a clue. It's like if you ask, I put the clue. Either Konj, Pallavi, anyone can answer. You're there?
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. I explained you two pictures, which were having a pituitary adenoma, and one more was a craniopharyngioma. So now I'm asking you to explain this picture. Which is a very different. This is how our exams are going to be. We learn 2+2 and this, such a things come.
Shravan here, could I try?
But you can easily solve this.
Come, Shravan here, could I try?
Okay, I put up a clue.
Hello?
Hello, ma'am.
Don't tell me the clue is deviating you more. What is that?
Ma'am, Shravan here, could I try, ma'am?
Sorry?
Ma'am, Shravan here, could I try explaining?
Sorry. I can't hear you.
Hello, ma'am. That's yeah. Shravan, ma'am. He wants to try. Hello?
Hello?
Yes, Shravan.
This is something similar to anterior chiasmal syndrome where the Willebrand's knee is affected.
Our connection is gone.
Is it fine? Can you hear me?
Fine, ma'am. It's fine now.
Yeah, cool. So, coming back.
Ma'am, Shravan was answering, ma'am.
Oh, yeah, Shravan. Yeah, very good. Come on. Yes.
Ma'am, this is something like anterior chiasma where the knee, that is the infranasal fibers, are also affected along with the ipsilateral complete optic nerve fibers.
Very good. Okay. I'm extremely, extremely happy with you, Shravan. Okay, next time we are meeting, you have a treat from me, okay? So, correct, whatever he said is correct. This is nothing but the von Willebrand's knee, okay? It's named that way. So, you have the nasal fibers which are actually decussating in the proximal part of the optic nerve itself, okay? So, it is not waiting till the chiasma. It is just going there up, bending and then coming down, which is called as the von Willebrand's knee. So if you have a lesion which is just affecting that part, so slowly you can have two kinds of pictures in your exam. Either it can be only a central scotoma or the whole thing.
Ma'am, the PPT isn't visible.
Sorry, 1 minute.
Yes, ma'am.
Can you see this now?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it fine?
Now,
is it visible? Yeah, cool. So yeah, we were discussing this. Nothing but, as Shravan rightly said, that it's the junctional scotoma, and very good. Somebody's naming it.
Of junctional scotoma of trachea is also the name given.
Correct. Spell traqueur.
T-R-A-Q-U-I-E-R.
E-R? Are you sure the spelling is right? Somebody's answered something on chat. Okay. Okay, no, the traqueur spelling was wrong. Okay, that's again a homework, okay? What you said is correct. It will not matter for you in your MCQ exam, but for your written exam, you probably have to write it properly. Okay, traqueur spelling. Next time I'll ask you all that. So you can have a picture like this. Either it can be a central scotoma with a superior temporal defect, or it can be the complete anopia with a superior temporal defect. Both are junctional scotoma only, okay? So, or you can tell you about traqueur. That is nothing but one eye is completely fine and the other eye you'll have this kind of scotomas, okay? Kunj, now you've answered in chat.
Yes, ma'am.
That's correct. Okay, did you Google?
No, ma'am.
Okay, this spelling is correct, which is T-R-A-Q-U-A-I-R, okay, not E.
Yes, ma'am.
So what we were discussing is this von Willebrand's knee. That means that the inferior nasal fibers take a turn like a knee in the proximal part of the optic nerve, and then they go to the other part of the optic tract, okay? And you have these fibers, which are the lower fibers, which take a turn in their own same optic tract also, okay? And then you have the macular fibers, which are also again posteriorly. So in most of you who are following Purana, they would have written it as anterior chiasmal, middle chiasmal, and posterior chiasmal lesions. And you'll be wondering what is happening there. So nothing to worry. It's just that this part of the fibers, when it's affected, they're terming it as anterior chiasmal. And this part of the fibers, when they are affected, it is termed as posterior chiasmal. So in the anterior chiasmal or the proximal part of the optic nerve, when it is affected, you can have a central scotoma or a complete anopia of that eye, depending on how many fibers are affected, and a junctional scotoma, that is the superotemporal fibers of the upper eye, because it carries the inferior nasal retinal fibers. Did it make sense to you all? Just answer me in the chat. Yeah, too. Okay, so we have done this much. Next. Yes. Just a minute. Yeah. Small lymphocyte. Thank you. Okay, so this is the, until now we were seeing only visual fields and probably only perimetry kind of pictures. But this is a beautiful city of Paris, and probably this person is very unfortunate to have a vision like this. What is happening here?
Again, bitemporal hemianopia.
It's a binasal.
Bitemporal, you're seeing, no?
Yeah, yes. So binasal.
So what is anopia, not seeing part?
Yes.
What is the not seeing part here?
Binasal hemianopia.
Yeah, correct. It is binasal hemianopia. What are the causes for binasal hemianopia?
The temporal fibers of both the sides are being compressed.
Yeah, that is the mechanism. What is the cause? Shravan is answering lateral chiasmal syndrome. Correct. But what is the cause? If you had to tell, okay, this is the cause. Like I said, optic nerve avulsion is the cause, or optic nerve infiltration is the cause there. And pituitary adenoma is the cause here. Same way for binasal, what is the cause? What can
compression
be the cause?
Of the optic nerve.
Yeah, I know. Compression of optic nerve. See, both sides, only temporal fibers are gone. So something to, whatever is there on both sides, can it, atherosclerosis, can you refine it? It's not going to cause binasal hemianopia. So many people have atherosclerosis. What third? What aneurysm can happen? Okay, third ventricle, what? Third ventricle compression is correct. Aneurysm is correct. Hiranmayee, you're right. Aneurysm, but which aneurysm? Carotid artery, good. Carotid artery aneurysms on both the sides can give you this. What other artery aneurysm can give you binasal? I'm seeing a lot of people answering on chat. Very good. And one more artery, posterior communicating. Excellent. Small lymphocyte. Thank you. Posterior, Anaga, you're also right. It's posterior communicating and carotid artery that can be affected, giving you by nasal amniotic, right? So with this, Kunj and Pallavi, thank you very much. Without you guys, I don't think this session would have made any sense. So let's now crack this. This is the same question that has appeared in one of your exams, and it's taken from a book only. So I've just put the picture the same way. So I would like you to answer these three questions based on this picture. This anyone can answer, even Pallavi, Shravan, Kunj. I'd be happy if you guys also answer.
Third one is B.
Third one is B. Okay.
Fourth is D.
Fourth is D. Okay.
Junctions.
Okay. This, if you answer this, our task for today's class is done. I will be A. Okay, Sarab, yeah. Can you want to please unmute her?
Oh, sorry.
Just a minute. Okay, there is some amount of confusion. Sarah, she's raised her hand. Shravan, can you please unmute her?
Yes, ma'am, I'm trying. Yeah.
Yeah. You can unmute yourself, Sarah, and answer. Proximal, okay. Still there's a confusion whether it's proximal or distal. Okay. Kunj had this confusion. So no, one of you can...
It would be proximal because eye is considered as a extension from the brain. So the nearest part of the brain is proximal and the more distal is the distal part. So it would be proximal.
Excellent. Yeah. So very good, Kunj. That's how you should be. You should raise the question. You should only answer it. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So very good. What you said is correct. So I don't think anybody has a doubt in this answer. This is left proximal optic nerve. Okay. And what we've discussed is nothing but the junctional scotoma. Same thing we just discussed just a few minutes back. So if you have a doubt here, then I would have to take the session again. Any doubt here? No, right? This is a junctional scotoma. This is not, we've not touched upon incongruous. We've not gone to temporal crescents yet. Nor is it bilateral centrosecal, so it's obviously junctional, okay? And Pallavi, come back to this question. Come back to this question three. You're going to answer this. Sarah, what happened to Sarah?
We have unmuted her, ma'am. But,
okay.
Sarah, want to answer?
It's okay. No, not an issue. Okay. You want to write it on the chat box, you can very well write it. Okay, so Pallavi, the ball's in your court again. The third question, I want you to answer this.
I actually guessed it. I'm not very sure about it, ma'am.
No problem.
Because in the anterior part, like, not anterior, sorry. Optic chiasma was involved, right? Where the on the Libram's knee was involved, right?
Yeah.
So I just took a guess. I'm not exactly sure.
Okay, so you have no reasoning behind. But what is the option that you're choosing?
That time I chose B, but now I'm not sure why I chose it also.
Okay, now do you want to change your answer?
Not sure.
Do you want to rule in, rule out something and come to an answer? Kunj, can you help her? Shravan, you can also try.
I think we can rule out AION because we in that we see an arcuate or a altitudinal hemianopia. So
excellent.
That would be
yeah.
The answer.
Okay.
That is ruled out.
Yeah.
Then... in glaucoma, like I haven't read glaucoma. Anything like this in glaucoma. Sir.
Okay.
We'll see a
central
paracentral scotoma, then
scotoma, yeah.
See, I'm telling you, you already diagnosed this as junctional scotoma.
Junctional scotoma.
Yes.
Okay, you know, see, question numbers 3 to 5 are based on this image.
And even it can't be D because D affects the posterior part of the spinal cord.
Yeah, correct. Okay.
So even that is out. So like A, B, and D out. So C may be the answer.
C may be the answer. Are you okay with this, Pallavi? You want to now opt for C?
Okay,
no. I'm asking you. I won't be there in your exam. No. To tell you, you have to opt one.
Yes, ma'am. See.
Okay.
It's
so
not A.
It's not A. Correct. Why not A? Because the glaucoma doesn't present this way. It has to come as a paracentral scotoma. Then you have the fetal scotoma. Arcuate and then double arcuate. And, correct. All that. Yeah. Roni's nasal step and doesn't appear like this. So A is ruled out. Then, as he told, D is ruled out. I don't think I have to explain it to you why D is ruled out and all. Anterior ischemic optic neuropathy presents most probably as an altitudinal. That means either it has to be the superior hemisphere or the inferior hemisphere. Okay, that's called as the altitudinal scotomas. So it is not B. So it is C. Or else, if you had paid attention to our slides, you would have seen this. Okay. Okay,
yes.
You just concentrated on the picture and didn't see what the three masses were, which were causing this kind of a junctional scotoma. It can be tuberculum stellae meningioma or a sphenoidal ridge meningioma or an olfactory groove meningioma as well. The most common one would be tuberculum stellae. If that is not there in the option, then go for olfactory groove meningioma. Okay, so here you can be smart enough to catch that. Or you can be smart enough to rule out options and come back to C. So the answer for the 3 is C, for 4 is junctional, and for 5 is the proximal part of the optic nerve. So I think we are done for today's class. The retrochiasmal lesions, I would be taking the next class. So if you want any particular topic that needs to be covered, you can write to me on my mail ID, which is ramyaarnadig@gmail.com. Anything, any comments, anything you want to say, you can just say, probably in 30 seconds.
Ma'am, Ramya, ma'am, that was amazing session, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for this opportunity. Thank you, Small Lymphocyte. Thank you so much, ma'am. Anything else? You can just tell me what.
Any doubts, guys? You can contact ma'am her email ID, or you can text any one of us actually, or you can ask in the next class also.
Yeah, we'll shortly schedule another class for the retrochiasmal lesions. I hope this class was something useful and a little different than what you normally have. So see you all again next week. Thank you. Thank you so very much, Shravan, Hiranmayi, Pallavi, and Kunj. Thank you so much.